Thank you. If I could ask members who are leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible, maybe with the exception of the Cabinet Secretary for Health. The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 430 in the name of Christine Grahame on the Mineworkers' Pension Scheme. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Would members who wish to participate in the debate please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. If you're joining us remotely, please put R in the chat function. And I call on Christine Grahame to open the debate around 7 minutes, Ms Grahame.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank those members who signed my motion? And let me commend the report by the Westminster Select Committee on Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy, whose unanimous cross-party report and the pursuit of this injustice by my colleague Owen Thompson, MP for Midlothian, brought me to this debate. And I may add also the Scottish Government, which has written to the UK Government supporting the recommendations. With not only Pennycook, Gorebridge and Newton Grange in my constituency, once at the heart of coal mining, and indeed with a maternal grandfather who was a Welsh miner, dying prematurely from injuries sustained in the pit well before I was born, I have a deep interest in what happens to miners and mining communities. I also, unfortunately, witnessed at the time in the 80s the mounted police charging into men fighting for their livelihoods and communities. A little bit of historical context to the pension arrangements. Currently, we have arrangements put in place in 1994 when the mines were privatised. Since then, the UK government has benefited from 50% of the surplus in the funds to the extent that it has received, and this is key, without contributing a penny, to the tune of £3.1 billion and additionally £1.3 billion from the investment reserve. There is a further £1.9 billion in the pipeline. Now, I've never seen a billion, but that's a lot of money. So the committee held an inquiry, and as I said, unanimously recommended that the 50-50 split should be reviewed, and as an interim, that £1.3 billion should be redistributed to the miners. This humongous sum contrasts with the actual pension miners receive. The median is £65 per week, such that 50% of members obviously receive less than that, 25% less than £35 a week, and 10% less than £18 per week. So, at the metaphorical coalface of life and paying for everyday bills, many miners are on the breadline, while thousands have been injured, like my mother's father, and died not even having enjoyed their pensions. It is estimated 7,000 members die each year. And remember, it was a job inherently dangerous, led to poor health, and by its very nature now is compounded by susceptibility to COVID, with predictably those underlying health conditions. Against all that, in my view, it's an affront to justice that the UK government creams off billions and has responded to the report with a rejection of all the recommendations. What is the justification? They claim that the guarantee that the UK government will plug any deficit is a reasonable defence if that scheme is vulnerable to failure. The reply from Anne-Marie Trevelyan, Westminster Energy Minister, was, and I quote, "The government continues to believe the arrangement agreed in 1994 was fair and beneficial to both scheme members and taxpayers. Scheme members have rightly shared in the benefits, but the government has taken on all the risk." Now, the reality is that even through the 2008 financial crisis and to date, this fund has thrived as the free billions are harvested by the UK government. Where is the evidence of risk, if any? Is it commensurate with a 50-50 split? I would add that the previous schemes assigned the surpluses at 70-30 in favour of the miners, the beneficiaries. The UK government has a sad track record in its attitude to the miners, starting, as I referenced, with the brutality of the treatment of decent folk defending their jobs and communities. This, of course, was compounded by the recent remarks by Boris Johnson, quotes, thanks to Margaret Thatcher, who closed so many coal mines across the country, we had a big early start and we're now moving rapidly away from coal altogether. Crass remarks, but quite in keeping with the disdain for the coal miners and their communities, and compounded now by the rejection of a review of the pension scheme. Irony of ironies, Westminster government is now controversially considering opening a fresh pit near Whitehaven, when it will of course need coal miners. This quite contrasts with this government, and I'll also say the Welsh Assembly, which is not this government, which is providing a pardon for miners convicted in the 1984-85 strike action in Scotland, and as I say, has also written to the UK government supporting that Westminster Committee's recommendations. Now, whether or not you have a mining community, I urge you to pursue this with your own MP to support the Select Committee and shame the government at Westminster for what make them once do right by the miners by accepting the unanimous recommendations, as I said, of this cross-party Select Committee. After all, the Westminster Energy Minister has said in a letter in reply to Owen Thompson MP, there's a chink of hope, quote, I am unable to accept the conclusions and recommendations. However, I hope that as a result of my discussion with the trustees, we can reach a mutually acceptable way forward. Can I suggest that you get writing? And let's hope that that's not just easy words, but there are actions to follow before more miners are in penitude and others die before they even receive their pensions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms Graham. We now move to the open debate. I call Annabel Ewing, who will be followed by Colin Smith. Ms Ewing, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And as the MSP for Cowdenbeath constituency, I'm pleased to be called to speak in this debate on the Mine Workers Pension Scheme. And I congratulate my SNP colleague, Christine Graham, MSP, in securing this important debate. And in fact, Christine Graham has just outlined in some detail the background to the privatisation of the scheme in 1994 and the financial arrangements put in place at that time. And in essence, as we have heard, in return for a UK government guarantee, there was to be a 50-50 split of any surplus. Presiding Officer, some 27 years later since the scheme was privatised, during which time the government, in fact, has accrued around £6.3 billion under the scheme without having, as we have heard, paid in a single penny. Very serious concerns have been raised about the plight of the miners who are supposed to be the beneficiaries of the scheme but who receive very low pension payouts and are struggling to make ends meet. As the MSP for former mining communities in Cowdenbeath constituency, I very much share those concerns. I would wish in the short time available today to highlight some of the key issues emerging from the April 2021 report of the Westminster Parliament's Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy Committee. And of course, these issues in fact led the committee to conclude unanimously that the scheme must now be reviewed and a better outcome for miners achieved. First, the option of a 50-50 split for a guarantee was presented at the time as a fait accompli, leaving the trustees with no choice but to accept. Second, the 50-50 split was entirely arbitrary. Indeed, the committee concluded at paragraph 17, and I quote, the government failed to conduct due diligence during the 1994 negotiations and undertook no empirical analysis or evaluation to inform or support the 50-50 split it proposed. The government was negligent not to take actuarial advice. What a damning conclusion, Presiding Officer. Third, the UK government has not paid in a penny over the lifetime of the scheme, but has accrued, as I said, some £6.3 billion. Indeed, it was noted in evidence before the committee that such an arrangement must be viewed as highly unusual and that, in fact, it would not be allowed today. Fourth, the UK government has received more than was expected, with the scheme having performed strongly, notwithstanding the global financial crash and the COVID pandemic. Fifth, the median pension, as we've heard, is a meagre £65 per week. And moreover, also as we have heard, half of the members in fact receive less than that, and that notwithstanding the chronic health issues facing many former miners and the debt privation suffered in the communities in which they reside. Six, sadly the number of pension members is decreasing by approximately 7,000 members per year, and therefore the time to sort this is running out. Seventh, the role of a guarantor is surely not to make a profit at the expense of the beneficiaries of the scheme. Eighth, there would be minimal risk to the UK Government as guarantor in changing the split to favour the beneficiaries, given the strong performance of the scheme, the considerable surplus that the UK Government has already accrued, and the reducing number of members of the scheme. Indeed, the question was posed at paragraph 39 of the report by the head of pension strategy at Coal Pension Trustees Limited, and I quote, "What is the true value of a guarantee that is extremely low risk and extremely unlikely to be used?" Presiding officer, it is quite clear that the scheme requires to be reviewed, and that as soon as possible. It is neither fair nor appropriate, and the scheme is also fundamentally flawed in its design. To date, the UK Government has set its face against such calls for a review and for an immediate transfer to the minor beneficiaries of the £1.2 billion currently in the Investment Reserve Fund. To many former miners and their families in my Cowdenbeath constituency, presiding officer, that intransigence and indeed hostility on the part of the UK Tory government will come as no surprise whatsoever, for they have been on the sharp end of that for decades. So in conclusion, I would urge the Scottish Government to do all that it can, even though, of course, the power here lies with the Westminster Government, but nonetheless to do all it can to urge the UK Government to do the right thing and to ensure that here in Scotland we do have a voice for former miners and their families, and we are determined to see right done by them. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Ewing. I now call on Colin Smith, who will be followed by Douglas Lumsden. Mr Smith, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And thank you to Christine Graham for tabling her motion. I'm immensely proud to represent the south of Scotland, a region that really is steeped in Scotland's mining history. As Christine Graham highlighted, Midlothian was one of those proud mining communities. In fact, at one time it contained 26 collieries employing, around 11,000 miners across the country. And of course, today houses the National Mining Museum. Neighbouring East Lothian is home to the earliest documented coal mines in Scotland, between Trinnen and the town of Preston Pans, where the local Labour Club ensured that local children were still being fed a hot meal after school every day during the miners' strike. In a region where Scotland's coal fields literally run almost continuously from the west to the east coast, some of the most valuable coal seams are, of course, in Lanarkshire, paving the way to making it the seat of the iron smelting industry at one time. And on the west coast, of course, in Ayrshire, around 14,000 coal miners at one time mined 4 million tonnes of coal annually. And a certain Keir Hardie founded the Ayrshire Miners Union, ultimately leading to the National Union of Scottish Mine Workers. Now, even in Dumfriesshire, where I live, an area many may not associate with coal mines, deep mining was integral to the economy as far south as Canonbay and Rowanburn, and more recently in Upper Nithsdale from the Faldhead Mine in Kirkconnell, the largest local pit until it closed in 1968, to the open cast that continued until just a few years ago. Now, many of my own relatives worked in those Upper Nithsdale pits until the demise of the industry in the 1980s. Some retired, and I should declare an interest there, now mining pensioners today. But some had to move out of the area to the northeast to find work in the oil industry. And, Presiding Officer, if there's one lesson we must take from the demise of the pits and the devastation that inflicted on our communities, many of which are still not recovered today, is that we must have a just transition for our oil and gas sector that creates new jobs for those that will be lost. Never ever again can we have government inflict such economic vandalism on communities and then walk away leaving industrial scale levels of unemployment. But not content with the pain inflicted in the 80s on those coalfield communities with Thatcher, and fresh from those crass comments joking about pit closures, his protege, or her protege, Boris Johnson, has added insult to injury by failing to right the injustice of the mine workers' pension scheme. As we've heard, since the Tories privatised British coal in 1994, the Treasury has stripped out 50% of any surplus. I will indeed, yes.
Mr Kerr.
May I ask the member to acknowledge that we actually had a long period of Labour government when these actions, which personally I support, the proposition that the committee, the Bayes Select Committee makes, but there were all those years of a Labour government. So the member cannot stand up and say what he's saying without accepting his party's culpability in the current situation as well. And this anti-Tory rhetoric is very tiresome.
Mr Smith.
Mr Kerr, I know you don't like to hear about the record of your government, but the reality is Labour's policy on this particular issue is very, very clear. It was the Tories who privatised British coal in 1994, and it was your government that created the injustice that's being held right today and still being rejected right at this moment in time. Your government has taken £4.4 billion that should have gone to miners and their families. It's those miners, not Tory ministers, those miners who toiled away down the pit, creating the wealth and prosperity. And frankly, this is the thanks that Mr Kerr's government give them right today.
Mr Kerr, please, enough of the sedentary interventions, please.
If Mr Kerr wants to intervene again, I'm happy to take his intervention, but I think I've made my position absolutely clear, and I've made my party's position absolutely clear, Mr Kerr. I'm proud of the fact that our manifesto in the 2019 election made it absolutely clear that we would redress and change this particular policy. Now, some of those pensioners that I've talked about have been left scrimping on, as we've already heard, a pension that's less than half of 65, or for half of cases less than £65 a week. Yet if there were ever communities that would need that extra spending power of local people having a few more pounds in their pockets, it's our coalfield communities that are in desperate need of regeneration. Labour's position on this is very clear. We believe that the sharing arrangement should be changed, whereby 90% of any surplus stays with the miners. That was in our manifesto at the election. Now, the fact that the Tories choose not to adopt Labour's policy of restructuring the pension scheme is obviously unsurprising, but frankly it's vindictive that they still do so in the face of calls from some of their own MPs. Now, it's a testament to the fighting spirit of all those campaigning on this issue that finally the Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy Select Committee in the UK Parliament conducted an inquiry into the pensioners' scheme. They made clear that the current 50-50 split of surplus was, as Annabel Ewan highlighted, arbitrary and it is also simply unfair. Yet the UK Government continues to reject putting right that injustice that miners and their families have suffered. And, President Officer, that is frankly shameful. Many of those former miners I know affected by this justice are elderly now. They paid their fair share into the pension scheme while they worked. It's high time they received their proper share out now in their later years. In many cases, those mine workers sacrificed their health working in dark and dangerous conditions to create the nation's wealth. Wealth that frankly remains unfairly distributed. A proper pension pot in retirement.
Need to be winding up now, Mr Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. A proper pension pot in retirement is not an aspiration, it's a right that those miners deserve.
Thank you very much, Mr Smith. I now call on Douglas Lumsden, who will be followed by Richard Leonard. Again, Mr Lumsden, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you to Christine Graham for raising this important debate. And I'm pleased to see her focus on Westminster and the importance of the work done by the UK Government on behalf of our mining communities across the United Kingdom. There is strength in that partnership, and one that has brought benefits to our miners through this pension scheme. It has been mentioned already, there was an important inquiry by the Select Committee and they heard evidence from all sides. But one thing that all participants agreed on was that the guarantee offered by the UK Government was essential to secure the benefits that the scheme has enjoyed. Indeed, the report states that the pension scheme made gains of 6.2% in 2020, far outperforming other schemes. The typical member's pension is around 33% higher in real terms than it would have been had they received only their actual earned pension up to privatisation. Yes, of course.
Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, the member, for taking intervention. He did mention the Select Committee's report. So I just wonder if he agrees with their summary conclusion. And I quote, the government should also relinquish its entitlement to the investment reserve and transfer the £1.2 billion fund to miners to provide an immediate cash uplift to former miners. Does the member agree?
Mr Lumsden, happy to give you the time back.
Okay, yes, the report is there, but of course the report also mentions that the fund is in a much stronger position because of that guarantee. The conclusions of that report state that the scheme has continued to produce strong results despite the 2008 financial crisis and the COVID pandemic. It's agreed by all parties that this is only due to the guarantee that the UK government continues to provide for the scheme. In 1996, there was a report by Binder Hamlin that concluded that no one was expecting the extent of future surpluses. The agreement was made by the trustees and the government for a 50-50 split in good faith. All parties signed up to that, and all parties were content with that. The split was agreed on the understanding that the UK government, as has been said already, would guarantee the scheme. And it is this guarantee that has meant that the trustees could invest in more high-risk investments that have undoubtedly paid off. And it's widely accepted that the bonuses would have been less or non-existent had the scheme not been guaranteed, and one witness at the inquiry even suggested that the pension payout may be smaller if the government guarantee was not in place. Yes, of course.
Christine Graham.
I honestly just seek clarity, Do you agree with the findings of the cross-party select committee, in which you had members, Conservative Party members?
Ms Graham, you should know better than to refer to you.
I beg your pardon.
Through the chair, please.
Does the member, and I shouldn't have used the U word, does the member agree with the findings of the select committee, which had a Conservative representative? And I commend the resilience and toughness of select committees at Westminster.
Mr Lumsden.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with the committees in Westminster. Often I see differences between the committees in Westminster and here. So the findings are there, and I think that is commendable. But the Minister has also said that her door is open to talk with the trustees, as you mentioned yourself. The trustees of the scheme have always prioritised the protection of the bonuses, which is right and proper for them to do. But for this to take place, the government has to have a means by which to secure those bonuses in a time of deficit. No one knows what the future holds. The Minister, in her evidence to the committee, was eloquent on that point. We do not know how the fund will perform in the future, or if there will be future deficits in the fund that require the guarantee to come into effect. No one could have predicted the success of the fund. And I want to turn now to the question of review. The Minister was very clear at the committee that her door was open. I met with union representatives on the 21st of June. At that meeting, the Minister asked the trustees to consider whether they would be willing to include the government guarantee in any future discussions around surplus sharing and the investment reserve. And I believe the Minister is still awaiting a reply. The government have been very open in their discussions. They are more than happy to discuss a change to the surplus that would mean removing the guarantee. To this point, the trustees have not been open to this. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, Scottish miners in all our constituencies have benefited from the strength of the guarantee offered by the UK government. Their bonuses have been more than they could have expected without that guarantee, and the strength of the scheme is clear. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Lumsden. I now call Richard Leonard, who will be followed by Emma Harper. Mr Leonard, again, around 4 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Christine Graham for bringing this most important debate before this Parliament? Because the pits may be gone, but the miners, their families and mining communities remain. And their voices must be heard in this Parliament. Progress on the pardoning of miners needlessly arrested, charged and convicted during the 84-85 strike was a victory for the principle of justice in the last session of Parliament. Now, in this session of Parliament, it is right that we move from the principle to the enactment of justice, and I welcome that. But other historic wrongs have to be righted too. Since the day the coal industry was privatised, and so the mine workers' pension scheme was in effect privatised as well, the UK Exchequer has not paid a single penny into the scheme, but it has taken £4.4 billion out of the scheme. When this was put to the Prime Minister in the 2019 election, he said this, and I quote him, "We will make sure all their cash is fully protected and returned." He said that no Mansfield miner is out of pocket. It was a promise made not just to the Mansfield miner, but to the Midlothian miner and to the Monmouth miner as well. So let me be as clear as I can be. This pension's betrayal of Boris Johnson and his repugnant view that Margaret Thatcher was some kind of eco-warrior, that her war on the miners was a big early start, is contemptuous. But it is not anti-Scottish. It is anti-working class. Those retired miners, those widows in Mansfield, Midlothian and Monmouthshire all have the same concerns, the same hardships, the same challenges, and we should not falsely divide them. The Business Energy and Industrial Strategy Select Committee called for reform of the scheme. These calls were supported by the pension scheme trustees, but not by Boris Johnson's Minister of State for Energy, Clean Growth and Climate Change, who shamefully twisted the truth, claiming the trustees supported her when they did not. They supported the Select Committee and the miners. In the end, the question for all of us is this. Do all those years of hardship and suffering, of struggle and sacrifice by the miners, do they count for nothing? We know the hazards, the risks, the dangers that forged those bonds underground have also brought in their wake chronic health conditions, which is why this betrayal of the miners by this government and this Prime Minister is a question of ethics and justice as well as a standard of living. This is a poignant time for those of us who place a value on working class history. 2 days ago, we marked the 71st anniversary of the Knockshinnock tragedy. This Sunday, we shall assemble at Auchengeach to remember the 47 miners who were killed there 62 years ago. In so doing, we rededicate ourselves to remember the dead, but also to fight for the living. It was the pioneering Labour MP John Wheatley who said presciently in 1926, "The miners are fighting alone, but they are fighting the battle of the whole nation. If they lose," said Wheatley, "we all lose." So this struggle for justice, today's struggle for justice, is not a struggle for the miners and their families alone. That is why they must not lose this fight. It's why this Parliament must support them to win. Because make no mistake, a victory for the miners will be a victory for social justice everywhere.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Leonard. I now call Emma Harper, who will be followed by Katie Clark. Again, around 4 minutes, Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I congratulate colleague Christine Graham on this debate this afternoon. Although this is not a debate which is directly relevant to Scottish Government policy, I absolutely agree it's important for us politicians and role models and as leaders of society to call out comments which are completely unacceptable. The comments made by Prime Minister regarding former Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher's decision to close the mines has given the UK a big early start on tackling climate change are not only unacceptable, they are deeply offensive. These comments show nothing other than the contempt with which the Prime Minister and the UK Government hold for former mining communities in Scotland. Many of these are located in my South Scotland region. And just as Christine Graham has invited the Prime Minister to visit the National Mining Museum in her constituency, I too am sure that many of members in former mining communities in my area would welcome a discussion with the Prime Minister on his views of mine closures under Mrs Thatcher as well. The reality of what the mine closures meant has been highlighted by ex-miner Ra Wilson when he said about the mine closures that they had no bearing on issues of tackling the climate emergency. Rab said, "Kirkconnell, Newcumnock, Auchinleck, all these villages are only here because of the coal. Socially and economically, it made these local communities. The Tories didn't give a second thought to the social catastrophe they were creating." Rab even put it into poems in his Scots language poems in his book, Accent of the Mind. "The richt to work, that was a' we asked. Demands which the Tories said went too far. For tellies, holidays, mibbies, a car. I'll never forget it. It's left its mark. It festers there, yet somewhere in the dark." So I have written to the Prime Minister also inviting him to join such a discussion, and I have agreed to organise it. Unsurprisingly, I have not had any response yet. Christine Graham has laid out the detail from the report of the money, the billions of pounds that should go to the miners, and Annabel Ewan described the pension amount of as little as £65 per week. The report that has been mentioned, it talks about the privatisation of British Coal in 1994, an arrangement which was made between the government and the trustees of the Mine Workers' Pension Scheme. And in the 2000s, the Coalfield Communities Campaign argued for a review of the surplus sharing arrangements, arguing that the guarantee had been struck on actuarial advice. With hindsight, it may have been too cautious in that a 50% share of an unexpectedly large surplus was too much. The consequences has been obviously a problem for our minors, and as Annabel Ewing has noted, there's not very many left now that would benefit from even any reforms. So I would like to ask the Minister to do whatever he can to support the minors in this continued effort to make sure that they are better benefited for any information that comes out of this well-worked Select Committee report. And again, I thank Christine Graham for bringing this debate to Chamber today.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call on Katie Clark, who will be followed by Carol Mochan, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Ms Clark, again, 4 minutes, please.
Thank you. And I congratulate Christine Graham on securing this debate and bringing this campaign into this Parliament, and she's absolutely right to raise this issue and the work of the Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy Committee. I'm pleased that the Scottish Government has already made their position clear, and I hope that going forward that we will try to give this issue as much attention as possible. There's been a great deal of discussion of history in this debate today, and of course the history of mining in Scotland is a brutal one. It was a history of what they called thurlage, which was basically slavery, and the conditions of the miners and mining communities were absolutely appalling. Not just coal mining, but tin and iron ore are the reason that many of the communities that we all represent actually exist, because people often literally worked beside their workplace and indeed had moved, often walked from another part of the country completely to live beside the mines that were built. It was very clear in the Select Committee report that the principle was that the government should not be benefiting and profiteering from miners' pensions. And I think that's the principle. I've always argued the trade union position that pensions are deferred pay. And the principle here is that those miners have paid into their pension scheme. We've heard a number of contributions highlighting the poor amount that many miners receive from their pensions from this scheme. And indeed, I understand that some widows are in receipt of as little as £8.50 per week. And of course, many of the miners that receive the pensions are still struggling with work-related illnesses as they get older. So I think there are many issues here about justice. And it seems to me, listening to the Conservative Party contributions, and I appreciate that they find the anti-Tory rhetoric tiresome and that they're attempting to detoxify themselves, it seems to me that this government at a UK level, and indeed the Conservative benches here, should be living up to the consequences of the actions that they forced through in the 1980s to that pit closure programme and to the devastation that that caused to communities up and down the country. Because the communities that we are talking about are not benefiting from the social economic justice that the UK government claims that it stands for, and are definitely not benefiting from levelling up with the kind of reaction that they've received from Boris Johnson to this Select Committee report. Those communities are still suffering from decades of deindustrialisation, of poverty, and a lack of economic justice and a lack of jobs. Generations literally have campaigned for economic justice for those communities since the 1980s. I'd be delighted to give way to the gentleman.
Stephen Kerr.
I respect completely the argument that Katie Clark's making, by the way. But she was a Member of Parliament during the time of the last Labour government, where this issue could have been dealt with, given the nature of the agreement that was reached in 1994. So why I said I tire of the anti-Tory rhetoric is that both Labour and the Conservatives are parties to what this agreement consists of, and therefore I think the partisan approach that's being taken by the Labour Party is ill-suited to the argument.
Katie Clark.
I'm grateful to the gentleman, and I appreciate the point he's making, but I would point out that unfortunately it's now more than a decade since Labour has been in power, and the reality is that as time has gone on, it's become clearer that the balance of risk is one that's very much against the miners. Now, I understand the point that his colleague was making earlier, that the government has taken on risk and has acted as a guarantor. But the principle surely is that it should be those that paid into the scheme that benefit from this scheme. And the Select Committee looked at these issues in detail and came to the conclusion that the government had been negligent at the time and that the only just solution now was that the benefit should be given to those that paid into the scheme, who live in some of the poorest communities in this country. And therefore, what I would say to Mr Kerr is that if his government at a UK level are serious about their levelling up agenda, then this is a very simple step that they could take that would put money into those communities, that would be an act that would show very clearly that they want to right some of the wrongs of the past, and that they want to make sure that those communities are given a fair chance. There's many other steps that obviously should be taken. This is a simple step, and I hope at the end of this debate we are united that this is a step the UK government should take, and it would be a simple step that would make a really significant difference to many people's lives.
Thank you, Ms Clark. And I now call on Carol Mochen, who will be followed by the Minister. Ms Mochen, again, 4 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To this day, the legacy of mining and the miners who made it happen are everywhere across South Scotland, particularly in my home area of Ayrshire, and indeed in Midlothian, as referenced in the motion. This is not just a legacy left on the earth, but a legacy of social, cultural and political energy that continues to reverberate. I'm speaking today to celebrate that legacy and the dedication of the miners who broke their backs for our country. They have not been forgotten by me or by the Scottish Labour Party. Hopefully, with a bit of common sense and decency, we can get them the pension they deserve. It is not much to ask. I know that there are those in other parties who would like to think they saw off the miners long ago, and thought many are, and though many are now retired or sadly no longer with us, the legacy of that industry lives on in the solidarity, grit and shared experiences of those communities. But it also lives on in the poverty that we've heard about, now seen in many of the ex-mining communities, and the struggle by miners themselves to achieve financial security for themselves and their families, now that their livelihoods and the highly skilled, well-paid jobs that came with it are all but gone. I'm disheartened to say that nearly 40 years after this process began, we're still having to stand up and defend miners and their family against a Tory government that simply did not care. A Tory government that saw destroying the power of the working classes as a priority above all else. Why would we expect any different now? It is likely the Treasury will earn around £23 billion from the Miners' Pension Fund in real terms over the next 60 years, but equally that could grow to as high as £55 billion. All the wealth and so little of it going to those who grafted for it. There was time when the Tories claimed to be all about getting Britain back to work and putting a pound in your pocket. I think we can see now whose pockets are bulging from the miners' money. Fortunately, in Scotland, we do have a majority against this callous injustice, and I fully support the call to give the £1.2 billion held in the investment reserve to the former miners. After all, this is what they are due. As is rightly mentioned in the motion, the great work of the Labour government in Wales serves as a fine example for Scotland to follow, and I have no doubt attempts to do so will be supported by almost everyone in this chamber. I only despair that we even had to demand this. This distribution of funds should have been reviewed long ago. Thank you to the member for bringing this important motion to the chamber.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mochen. I now call on Tom Arthur to respond to the debate. Minister, you have around 7 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by thanking my colleague, Christine Graham, for bringing this very important motion to the Chamber today? And can I also thank members across the Chamber for their contribution? It's clear that many decades may have passed, but this is still a live issue. I think that is a point that has been captured by many members. And reflecting upon a contribution that Richard Leonard made of the need to right historic wrongs, and what Carol Mochen said is, it's not much of an ask, I think was the expression Ms Morgan used. And I recognise we have many challenges, many complex or wicked problems, but when we're presented with an opportunity to right a wrong and to do the right thing where we can all unite, we must seize that. And we also must learn the lessons of the importance of a just transition, so that decades from now we are not debates taking place in this Parliament because we have failed to learn the lessons of previous generations. I also want to recognise the contribution that was made by Annabel Ewing. In particular, she highlighted a very important element of the Bayes report, which I think is an excellent report, and I commend the committee for their work. And that's a point, also a point that's been picked up by other members, which the UK government should not be engaging in profiteering. That is not the purpose of that pension fund. And I also want to recognise the contributions of members illustrating the rich history of mining across Scotland and indeed the wider UK. I only have to look back at a few generations of my own family to find miners in Ayrshire and in Lanarkshire, and I recognise the often horrendous conditions that they had to work under. I would also want to recognise the contribution of Mr Lumsden, which, if he would, I hope he doesn't mind me saying, but it really just seems to be a statement of what the UK government's existing position is. I did have some hope that when Mr Kerr intervened on Mr Smith, I picked up it suggested that Mr Kerr agreed with the recommendations of the Bayes Committee. If my sedentary position is indicating he's doing so, I welcome that, and I hope that where there may be a difference of opinion across the Conservative group in this place, that Mr Kerr will be full-throated in supporting the government and members across this chamber in calling for the UK government to do the right thing. I'd be happy to.
Stephen Kerr.
I'd like to point out I'm being consistent to the position I took when I was a member of the House of Commons representing the Stirling constituency, where there were many retired miners who brought this issue to my attention. So I am being consistent. I'm also being consistent as a former member of the Select Committee that produced this report. I believe that the Conservative colleagues that I have, or former colleagues I have that are on this committee, will have received the evidence, and their unanimous conclusion, I think, is based upon that evidence. Therefore, it's an easy thing to support. I don't belong to the UK Parliament now. I'm a member of the Scottish Parliament. My job is to hold your government to account, the Minister's government to account, and therefore I'm free to comment on the UK government at will.
Thank you. Minister.
You'll regret that.
Can I... As he is a new member of this Parliament, I think he's making an excellent start, and I would fully encourage him in that approach and to share it with Mr Lumsden as well. Presiding Officer, the Mineworkers Pension Scheme was established in 1952 and was close to new members upon the privatisation of British Coal in 1994. There are over 120,000 pensioners receiving benefits from the scheme and over 10,000 deferred members, with the average pension being under £100 per week. Indeed, I understand that 10% of the pensioner membership receives less than £18 per week. Former Scottish mine workers and their widows are amongst these pensioners. Inevitably, their numbers are sadly diminishing year on year. Over centuries, thousands of Scots lost their lives underground, and even in the last few decades of the industry, working conditions remained dangerous. Many former mine workers continue to suffer chronic health conditions as a result of their occupation, an issue particularly acute given what we have collectively endured over the past 18 months. Of course, times have changed and our priorities for energy are rightly refocusing on sustainable and renewable sources as we strive for a just transition away from fossil fuels. However, we should not forget the critical historical role that mine workers played over many decades, including in the transformative period between nationalisation and privatisation of the industry and extracting coal to fuel our communities and propel society into the modern age. I understand, as other members have referenced, the National Mining Museum in the former Lady Victoria Colliery in Christine Graham's constituency provides visitors with a vivid reminder of the conditions in which mine workers toiled and the gratitude owed to them by all of us. I very much hope to visit the museum soon. As the Chamber is aware, responsibility for occupational pensions is reserved to Westminster, and this Parliament has no influence over decisions affecting the mine workers' scheme or the arrangements set out in the UK legislation in 1994. It was right that upon privatisation in 1994, the UK government provided assurances and a guarantee to former mine workers to protect the value of their pensions. It is also right that the risk to the taxpayer was acknowledged.
The arrangements are technical, as has been touched on, in the return for the provision of a guarantee. The UK Government is currently entitled to a half share of scheme surplus, a so-called 50-50 share with the scheme members. The fund has four notional sub-funds. A guaranteed fund provides inflation-proof pensions to former mine workers and their dependents. There is an investment reserve based on the £1.2 billion surplus bequeathed from British coal days. Two other components complete the arrangements, with a bonus augmentation fund for payments to members and a guarantors fund from which the UK Government's share of benefits are derived. I do recognise that the scheme trustees would have welcomed the guarantee, which permitted an investment strategy seeking higher returns, which has benefited members through bonus payments over years. However, at the time the arrangements were entered into, it was estimated that the surplus might amount to £2 billion over the course of a quarter of a century. In reality, the UK Government's dividend amounts to over three times that figure. In the unlikely event the guarantee is ever called upon, it is expected that the risk to the taxpayer would fall short, well short, of what has already been paid in. I have read the report of the Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy Select Committee, which, as you are aware, sets out key recommendations in relation to the arrangements entered into in 1994. The committee describes the 50-50 arrangements as arbitrary, having found no substantial contemporary assessment being undertaken. They are also quite exceptional. I agree with the findings of the Select Committee, in particular about the future division of surpluses. There is a strong case for a more equitable distribution to surpluses to scheme beneficiaries, many of whom are on low incomes, and an arrangement that better reflects the risks of the scheme management and assurance. One of the Select Committee's key recommendations is turning over the investment reserve to pensioners, which is a step that could have a material impact on thousands of low-income households. The UK Government has rejected the recommendations and has set out it continued to believe the arrangement agreed in 1994 was, to use their words, fair and beneficial to both scheme members and taxpayers. However, the Chair of the Select Committee has understandably responded in strong terms, asking the UK Government to reconsider. The scheme trustees are also disappointed, and given they consider the essential guarantee to the operation of the scheme, they must feel they have little scope for alternative action. And that is a crucial point to make in reference to what Mr Lumsden said, because the UK Government may say that their door is open, but if they are only going to engage in conversation if the condition is to remove the guarantee, then that is not openness, that is not transparency, that is not engagement, and that is what needs to change. The National Union of Mine Workers has also called for a more balanced approach to the distribution of funds and the investment reserve. I note the UK Government's position, but as I say, that ministers are open to further dialogue with trustees and an arrangement that sees the scheme retain 100% of surpluses. But as I say, this appears to be entirely conditional, however, and in removing the guarantee, that is not a genuine offer. It places trustees in an invidious position, so it's not acceptable. The UK Government has been a substantial beneficiary of the arrangement for a quarter of a century. The time for it to stop taking and to do the right thing is long overdue. That is why, as members will be aware, I am writing to the UK Government and the trustees of the Mine Workers Pension Scheme, asking that the arrangements are reviewed so that former mine workers can, in retirement, be properly recognised for the work they undertook on behalf of other countries across the UK for many years. Including, Presiding Officer, these discussions should be transparent and include expert input from actuaries and have the interests of pensioners at their centre, and action should be taken as soon as possible. I sincerely hope that the concerns of many on this issue are heard by the UK Government and the recommendations are given full consideration in mutually supportive discussions. And I call on this party to support the recommendations of the Select Committee. And I once again thank Christine Grahame for bringing this important issue to the Chamber.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this sitting of Parliament until 2 p.m.